Hello friends, welcome back to this video series on saluting women in history. This video is a continuation of the previous one on Indian women in freedom struggle, and it will stress on the history of the freedom movement with special reference to the role played by the women in Tamil Nadu. Indian women's participation in the struggle began as early as 1817 AD, and the entire history is replete with the saga of bravery, sacrifice and political sagacity of hundreds and thousands of women of our country. While discussing the women warriors who fought with valor for India's independence, the person we remember the most is Rani Lakshmibai of Jhansi. But a deeper dive into the history brings us to Velu Nachiyar, the queen of the kingdom of Sivagangai, presently a part of Tamil Nadu. She was the first queen in Indian history to have waged a successful war against the British. Her husband, Muthu Vaduganatha Periya Udayadevar, the king of Sivagangai, was killed at war against the combined forces of the British and Nawab of Arcot at Kalayar Koil. Fleeing with her daughter Vellachi to Virupachi, she was all determined to take vengeance against the British and remained in hiding at Virupachi for 8 years. With the support of neighboring kings like Gopala Nayakar and Haider Ali, she managed to build a huge army that included a big contingent of women warriors under the banner of Udayal Padai in memory of Udayal, who is a servant girl who quenched the queen's thirst with water and sacrificed her life when she refused to oust her to the British. Kuili, Velu Nachiyar's right-hand maiden, commandeered the Udayal Padai while the queen herself trained them to perfection. Kuili was a beauty with brains and was one of the ablest of the queen's commanders. In 1780 AD, Velu Nachiyar formed an alliance with few neighboring kingdoms and marched with their allies and army towards Sivagangai. They encountered and defeated the forces of Nawab of Arcot and the British, who were commanded by Captain Martins at Manamadurai. At Kalayar Koil, she defeated the British forces and killed Captain Joseph Smith. Again, in a face-to-face fierce battle ensued, where the British were defeated and their leader Captain Benjor surrendered. He pleaded for his life, promising that the British would never interfere with the affairs of Sivagangai in the future. Velu Nachiyar showed mercy and spared the captain's life and set him free. When the Queen's army fought and won the battle, Kuili went on to become the first woman martyr to willingly sacrifice her own life for India's freedom struggle. Like the commander Kuili, another notable woman, Vadivu Nachiyar, wife of Veerar Sundaralingam, also helped the Queen Velu Nachiyar and sacrificed her life for the nation. The legacy of Queen Velu Nachiyar, who is popularly known as India's Joan of Arc, has been recorded through books, novels, videos, and a postage stamp was released in the Queen's name by the Government of India in 2008. The role of Tamil Nadu women in the freedom struggle had become the epic story of the selfless, dynamic, talented and patriotic women. Many of them had to encounter stonewalling opposition at every level, from the household, community, in area of functioning and the alien administration. But the band of pioneers who evolved in the late 19th and early 20th centuries gave direction to the mass of the deprived women, and it ensured the realization of their rights and redressal of grievances on par with men in the society. The period from 1857 to 1947 could be considered as the era of women empowerment, because during this period many women forgot their homes and worked for India's national struggle. And this experience helped Tamil women not only to enter into the political field, but it also gave them more confidence and strength. The foundation stone was laid by a young woman, Thillaiyaadi Valliyammai, who was a South African Tamil woman, and Mahatma Gandhi gave her credit for staying the course in fight for equality in South Africa. She developed her non-violent methods in South Africa and famed to have inspired Mahatma Gandhi in his fight against the British colonial rule in India. She influenced the minds of Mahatma Gandhi very much, though she died very early when she was 16 years old. And it is to be mentioned here that the Government of India released a commemorative stamp for her on 31st December 2008. The National Movement in Madras Presidency was rather slow. slow but steady and progressive till the commencement of the 20th century. The Indian National Congress came into existence during the year 1885, and it is quite interesting to note that the Congress met again and again in Madras during the years 1887, 1894, 1903, 1914 and 1927. The beginning of the 20th century was the time when the Swadeshi movement spread throughout India, and the boycott of foreign made goods and the promotion of Swadeshi enterprise saw various activities in Madras Presidency. G. Subramanya Iyer played a key role in spreading the ideas of Swadeshi, and his lectures in Madurai aroused powerful nationalist feelings among the students of Madurai Native College in 1906. Though the role of women in Madras was less significant than those in Bombay and Bengal, they picketed and marched in processions. However, it was a difficult thing for them to mobilize in large numbers for action. But some women in Madras went door to door and preached the value of Swadeshi, organized Swadeshi exhibitions and sold khadar in the streets. They also joined men in picketing and sometimes would walk through the streets singing songs of Swadeshi and Swaraj. Even the traditionally home-centered women of the urban middle classes also joined processions and picketing, whereas the educated women provided leadership to the unmobilized women and thereby organized them to fight for national independence. Another important point to be highlighted here is that women from Madras Presidency never joined the revolutionary movement, nor they were the subjects of extreme police violence. The years following the First World War are most outstanding in the annals of the freedom struggle, for during this period, an organized and countrywide attempt to overthrow the foreign rule was begun by boycotting the government on essential things and by launching Satyagraha. As elsewhere in India, the Home Rule movement and the non-cooperation movement brought the women of Tamil Nadu to the forefront of freedom struggle. Women theosophists like Miss Arundel, daughter of Mr. G.S. Arundel, Dorothy Jina Rajadasa and Sivagamu Ammal were notable women Home Rule members. At that time, Sivagamu Ammal was a medical student who studied at Bombay. She left the college and became a Home Rule worker, protesting against the order forbidding students to take part in politics. In a meeting convened at Madras by the Madras Home Rule League on August 1917, Miss Arundel was extended a warm welcome. The British government arrested Annie Besant for her agitation towards Home Rule. Subsequently, in order to get her released, a special meeting was held at Triplicane on 14th September 1917 by Dorothy Jina Rajadasa and another English woman from Adyar settlement. Meanwhile, the leaders of the Home Rule League popularized the idea of passive resistance among the Mafsal people by distributing vernacular leaflets, illustrated postcards, and by way of public meetings and processions, which had an immediate effect on the people. As an outcome, the government of Madras directed the district magistrates to discourage protest meetings, especially street processions. When Annie Besant came to Madras after her release, a large assemblage of women showered congratulations profusely. Sivagamu Ammal also played a prominent part in the Home Rule movement. She attended almost all the meetings held in Madras in connection with it. In continuation, the freedom fighters in the Madras Presidency observed 24 hours fasting, processions and meetings, and it is also remarkable to note here that in Madras, Mohammedans and women were present in large numbers than in any other political meetings. This was a time when the Khilafat agitation continued with renewed vigor at an all India level. The ideas of non-cooperation, boycott and Swadeshi were advocated by the participants of the national struggle. And when the leadership of the Congress movement was passed over to Mahatma Gandhi, he charted out the national program in such a way as to give opportunities to all classes of people. Mahatma Gandhi introduced Khadi as an important Congress program, especially with the objective of including women. As a result, a number of women activists from the Madras province participated in the Congress programs of boycott of foreign cloth, promotion of Khadi and picketing of liquor shops. During the year 1921, Moovallur Ramamrudam Ammayar, an ardent follower of Mahatma Gandhi, worked for the establishment of educational institutions called as Kalvi Koodam. Padmasini Ammayar established the Sisters Association at Cholavandan in Madurai during the period 1921-22, and another woman by name Thayar Ammayar were also associated with the association. Mrs. Rosapu Turai, wife of Judge George Joseph, participated in the non-cooperation movement in a prominent manner. Radhabai Subbarayan also participated and played a prominent role in the freedom struggle during the phase of non-cooperation movement. On top of all these things, press began to play a leading role in mobilizing women, and it worked out very well in the prohibition movement, which began to spread in almost all the districts of the Madras Presidency before the end of February 1921. Rajagopalachariar, Ramaswamy Periyar and Rangaswamy Iyer organized volunteer corps known as Thondar Padai to picket liquor shops throughout Tamil Nadu. The British authorities arrested, imprisoned them and imposed a curfew order. But even after their arrest, Nagammai and Kannammal, along with many other women, were drawn into the movement at Erode. Fearing that the law and order situation would get out of control if all the women were arrested, the British government lifted the 144 ban order. When the Indian National Congress asked Mahatma Gandhi to stop the movement, he replied that it was not in his hands and it was only in the hands of two women from Erode. This clearly shows the involvement of the duo Nagammai and Kannammal had made in the movement. An interesting incident should be highlighted over here. In 1924, Kadalur Anjalai Ammal was not given permission to meet Gandhiji when he visited her region. In order to meet him at any cost, she took a brave measure of wearing parda completely covering her and rode in a horse cart and finally succeeded in her attempt of meeting him. Due to this reason, she was called as South India's Jhansi Rani by Mahatma Gandhi. Besides, Gandhiji was attracted by her daughter Amma Kannu, who was taken along by him to Wardha in order to provide her complete education. In 1925, Ambujat Ammal established a woman NGO called as Srinivasa Gandhi Nilayam at Madras for spreading the messages of nationalism. This act of her much influenced the thoughts of Mahatma Gandhi, and he began to consider Ambujat Ammal as his foster daughter. Another important incident which could be shown as a proof for the patriotism of women was when the annual session of the Indian National Congress was held at Madras in 1927. There were 60 women volunteers wearing orange-red khadi saris on constant duty at the annual session under the leadership of Rukmani Lakshmipati. She was appointed as the secretary of the women's section of the Congress and was assigned the task of looking after the guests who came to attend the meeting of the Congress. Rukmani Lakshmipati welcomed Jawaharlal Nehru and others who came to Madras by spending money from her own pocket towards the hospitality of guests. Women such as Salem Angachi Ammal, Kadalur Anjalai Ammal, Kannu Ammal and Mrs. Lakshmi Ammal actively participated in the Neel Statue Satyagraha movement during 1927. They were arrested and suffered imprisonment in connection with this Satyagraha. During the meantime, in order to continue the Satyagraha, Tamil Nadu Congress Committee formed an executive committee consisting of Hiralal State, Tirumalacharya, Srinivasa Varadan and Padmasini Ammal, which passed a resolution asking the government to remove the statue immediately. Since the British government did not pay any attention to the Congress demand, they continued the agitation with all difficulties until it was suspended. Annie Besant and Hansa Mehta played a leading role in opposing the Simon Commission in Madras Presidency. In order to plan the boycott, Annie Besant convened a meeting of the important leaders of Madras at New India Building on 9th November 1927. In addition, earlier in December 1927, the local women formed a committee to organize and regulate the boycott of the Simon Commission. As a result, on 1st February 1928, women's meeting was held at Madras where Yamini Purna Tilagamma, Masilamani Ammal, Rukmani Lakshmipati and others spoke in support of the boycott. Padmasini Ammal also supported the decision very strongly. The famous organization known as Women's India Association opposed the commission for two reasons, namely exclusion of Indians in general and exclusion of Indian women from the commission. Because of the continuous effort of the Women's India Association, 5 pages were devoted to women in the Simon Committee report. The Indian National Congress passed a famous resolution of complete independence at the Lahore Congress session in 1929. Gandhi decided to launch the civil disobedience movement and declared 26 January 1930 as Independence Day. Mahatma Gandhi drafted a list of demands and chose 3, such as the prohibition of liquor, reduction of land tax and abolition of salt tax. He wrote a letter to Lord Irwin, the Viceroy of India, on 2nd March 1930, requesting him to concede his demands or otherwise he had to face the salt satyagraha. Lord Irwin never turned to Gandhi's demand. Then Mahatma Gandhi commenced the salt satyagraha march on 12th March 1930 to break the salt law at Dandi from Sabarmati Ashram with 87 Satyagrahis. Further, Mahatma Gandhi appealed to his countrymen to start the movement at their respective regions. The people all over India readily responded to the appeal of Mahatma Gandhi, and in Tamil Nadu, Rajaji led the salt satyagraha at Vedaranyam. Gandhiji was arrested on 6th April 1930 for breaking the salt law. His arrest was a long-awaited signal, and the campaign started with countrywide hartals. And it specially electrified the patriotic zeal in women, which not only gave a twofold strength and support to the cause, but also invited attention and appreciation from the outside world. Women started their march on the road to liberty by breaking salt laws, taking out processions, picketing schools, colleges, legislative councils and clubs. Muthulakshmi Reddy, who was then the member of Legislative Council of Madras Province, resigned her post, and similarly, Kamala Devi Ammayar of Tirunelveli resigned her honorary judge post against the arrest of Mahatma Gandhi. In Madras, Srimati Lukmani Lakshmipathy had the honor of being the first lady to be arrested in connection with the salt satyagraha, since she was the acting president of the Tamil Nadu Provincial Congress Committee. She was also the first woman to pay fine for her participation in the civil disobedience movement. Salt satyagraha also happened in Madras near the High Court under the leadership of T. Prakasam during the year 1930. A young lady, Durgabai Deshmukh, emerged popular through her participation in this incident, and she experienced even the police lathi charge. The press of Madras supported her to the core level and stated that she could act as a perfect guide to the women community. The press and newspapers such as Bharati, Swadeshi Mitran, Navasakti, The Hindu and later on Anand Viganan began to play a prominent part for enthusing the patriotic spirit in the minds of the people in Tamil Nadu. There were also a number of women in the Madras Presidency who played a prominent part in organizing youngsters into the Vanar Sena. The patriotic fervor of freedom struggle got ignited by the songs written during that period, like Namakkal Kavinger Ramalingam Pillai, who was famous for his patriotic songs. K.B. Sundarambal, popularly known as Kodumudi Kogilam, also became very popular for her song Gandhiyo Parama Elai Sanyasi, sung by her in the drama stages all over Tamil Nadu. Therefore, these incidents sowed the seeds of patriotism in the minds of young men and women, and the dynamic energy of these youngsters was thus utilized into systematic and disciplined activity. In 1931, Margaret Cousins, who was associated with the Women's India Association, worked vigorously and insisted on the sale of Indian-made goods in Madras. Kodainayagi Ammayar participated in the prohibition movement at Triplicane in Madras during the same time. Muthulakshmi Reddy conducted the consultation meeting with the women's organizations in Madras in order to boost up the participation of women in the struggle for freedom. As a result, when the first roundtable conference was held in 1931, though Congress leaders did not participate in it, the representative of Women's India Association gave their participation. Radhabai Subbarayan from the Kumaramangalam Zameen family participated in the first and second roundtable conferences. In 1934, Rukmani Lakshmipathy was elected as the first woman MLA by the people directly. During the period between 1937-40, when Rajaji formed the Congress government in Madras, the individual satyagraha was started, and Saraswati Pandurangan from Madurai played an important role in the same. Similarly, Lakshmi Bharati Ammayar, daughter of Navalur Somasundara Bharathi, also participated in the individual satyagraha from Tiruparankundram. On 8th August 1942, Mahatma Gandhi gave the call for British colonizers to quit India and for the Indians to do or die to make this happen. Soon after, Gandhiji and almost the entire top Congress leadership was arrested. There began a truly people-led movement in our freedom struggle. An aspect of the movement that is rarely spoken about is the way it encouraged women to come out of the thresholds of their homes and raise their voice against the British rule. With majority of the men behind the bars, women took to the streets, raising slogans, holding public lectures and demonstrations, and even making and transporting explosives. Women were also one of the worst sufferers of British retaliation. It was common for British officials to forcefully enter households and slap, beat up, and rape women. While women numbering in hundreds had participated in agitations, there are some women who left a clear mark when one talks about the role of women in the Quit India movement. They took out processions, held meetings, demonstrations, and organized strikes. When leaders were arrested, Rukmani Lakshmipathi became the acting president of the Tamil Nadu Provincial Congress Committee and took the initiative in order to keep the organization alive. The most significant event during the Quit India movement was the participation of the women students. They played a spirited role in accelerating the national struggle. Students of the Queen Mary's College and Women's Christian College abstained classes and organized hartals, processions, and picketing. Manjubhashini Ammayar played an important role in the Quit India movement. During this period, peasants, women workers of mills, and contract laborers in the harbors participated in the freedom struggle in large numbers. The name of Krishnammal Jagannathan has to be highlighted over here for her participation in the Bhutan movement of Minoba Bhave. And it is very much important here to state that she is the Padma Bhushan awardee for the year 2020. On 14th August 1942, Kamala Devi Arya was arrested for distributing leaflets. Mrs. Soundaram Ramachandran helped the families of the people who were in jail in connection with the Quit India movement. Hundreds of laborers from the Buckingham and Carnatic mills struck work. Anthony Ammal and Pechi Ammal from Coimbatore participated in the Pangajam mill strike, which was part of the movement. They were arrested and lodged in Coimbatore jail and Velur jail. Kutti Ammal and Chole Ammal from Coimbatore were imprisoned when they broke the railway line at Singanallur with nearly 100 women workers. Meena Krishnaswamy from Madurai, Narayana Ammal from Ramnad, and Anjali Ammal from South Arcot were arrested and imprisoned for shouting anti-war slogans. Therefore, the role of women in Tamil Nadu during the Quit India movement of 1942 was very impressive. While thousands of women joined the freedom movement responding to Mahatma Gandhi's call, there were a few who could not accept his creed on non-violence. Notable among them was Lakshmi Swaminathan, daughter of Ammu Swaminathan of Madras. She joined the Indian Independence League formed in January 1942 at Kuala Lumpur to fight for India's freedom. Later, its name was changed into Indian National Army. In July 1943, Subhash Chandra Bose addressed a meeting, and his call to women to share the burden of the battle for freedom brought new spirit into the movement. As a result, a women's regiment popularly known as the Jhansi Rani Regiment was formed with Lakshmi Swaminathan as its captain. When the Indian National Army collapsed, she did not surrender to the British, but she was captured and later placed under arrest. As a prelude to independence, during the year 1943, the tricolour flag was hoisted and Radhabai Ammayar headed the same. After gaining independence, Omanthura Ramasamy hoisted the national flag in Fort St. George, and the song ஆடுவோமே பல்லு பாடுவோமே
ஆடுவோமே பள்ளி பாடுவோமே ஆனந்த சுதந்திரம் அடைந்து விட்டோம் சுதந்திரம் என்பத பேச்சு எங்கும் சுதந்திரம் என்பத பேச்சு நாம் எல்லாரும் சமம் என்பது
written by poet Subramanya Bharathi, was sung by T.K. Pattammal, which attracted the attention of the people all over Tamil Nadu. Though the Quit India movement could not succeed in the face of British retaliation, it definitely punched a hole into British governance, making the colonizers realize that the cost of ruling over the Indian subcontinent had risen substantially. 6 years down the line, that is on 15th August 1947, the tricolour would be raised again to bid goodbye to the British. Remarking upon the role played by women in the freedom struggle, Mahatma Gandhi had said, "When the history of India's fight for independence comes to be written, the sacrifice made by the women will occupy the foremost place." Women from Tamil Nadu shouldered critical responsibilities in the struggle for India's freedom by holding public meetings, organizing picket of shops selling foreign articles, and sold khadi. They even excelled as speakers, marchers, campaigners, and tireless volunteers. Thus, they played an active role in the Swadeshi, non-cooperation, civil disobedience, and Quit India movements, and their contributions are truly remarkable. As India celebrates 74 years of independence, I am extremely happy and proud to honor the lives and exemplary work of these women by paying this visual tribute and registering a big salute in history.
Thank you for watching.
Please like, share, and subscribe to this channel.